Where Do We Go From Here? By Philip Agee. Excerpted from the book Dirty Work, The CIA in Western Europe, Dorset Press, May 1988. The feeling is one of being completely overwhelmed, like drowning in controversy, issues, sensational revelations, myriad opinions from everywhere on what to do. It's not just the energy required for absorbing well over 2,000 pages of official reports from the Rockefeller Commission, the Senate and House investigating committees, the Murphy Commission, and the Ford reforms. There's also 2 years' accumulation of continuous media output, heavy enough for an average observer, an interested journalist, or even a political activist. Heavier still, for someone who has been a part of the controversies for 2 years after having spent 4 years researching and writing an account of the preceding 12 years' work inside the CIA. I've read all those reports and hundreds of newspaper cuttings because I want to get perspective on what's happened with the CIA, FBI, and other intelligence and security services. I want to be able to judge whether anything has changed, or whether business will go on as usual inside the political police forces once the sensations subside. Not many people worked on both sides. Lots were victims, and others were victimizing. My distinction, I suppose, was to have done both. But that makes evaluation harder, not easier. And of course, I can be no impartial observer. So many people have asked, often not so delicately, how in hell I've survived, and why the CIA didn't make me disappear, and don't I think I'm in danger? I used to laugh, but not now. Now, I too am beginning to wonder. Studying the results of the different investigations produced a kind of psychological disorientation, now a little schizophrenic, now a little paranoid. I'd go along reading intensely about the nature of counterintelligence, or about problems of coordination among agencies, or about the functions of the Director of Central Intelligence with the same kind of uncritical, receptive mind frame I'd had studying the very same things in the CIA's training classrooms back in 1957. Suddenly, I would realize where I am now, having done the unthinkable in resolving to take positive action against the CIA by revealing its operations and naming all those names. Like alternating between two personalities, like the way I vacillated for a time over whether to name any names at all. Perhaps a partial throwback to the Jesuit-imbued attitude of being in the world, but not of it. Just as often, I'd get the feeling that some disaster was imminent, that there's simply no way to survive the immense and vast apparatus for repression that I was reading about. Sure, I was reading about the past, but every morning I was also reading of people disappearing in Buenos Aires, assassinations of Uruguayans I might have known, suicides in jail. Then a friend would telephone and ask me what that odd clicking sound was, and I'd say, they probably just don't want me to forget they're there. Then back to reading, and to straining my imagination to comprehend the CIA's plot to give Fidel Castro a diving suit dusted inside with enough fungus to give him a chronic case of Madura foot skin disease, with the suit's breathing apparatus also contaminated with tuberculosis bacilli. Attitudes, feelings, emotions, they add up to a sense of vulnerability to retaliation. Maybe once the dust stirred up by revelations and investigations begins to settle. But no thought of withdrawal into some secure isolation, even if that were possible. That's what I did for a while after leaving the agency. Now is the time to sum up, evaluate what's been accomplished, and look ahead to the next round. Conventional Europeans often express dismay over our American propensity for self-destruction. They see us as a society bent on some kind of super explosion, and then perhaps collapsing into a black hole. More often than not, I suspect, what these people really fear is that America will cease being the main prop for their own failing economic and social systems. Cold War rhetoric revives as new efforts appear to create a psychological climate of fear and tension with respect to national survival. We see this in America as well. Those of us who see the CIA and other security services as impediments to achieving a higher form of democracy must answer the charge that we are encouraging world domination by the Soviet Union, that we are paving the way for imposition of a Soviet-style system in the United States, that we are increasing the possibility of nuclear war by encouraging the development of global imbalance. If the past few years are any indicator, maybe before this century ends, the U.S. and some few allies, like South Africa and Israel, could end up isolated and armed to the teeth in an increasingly hostile world with nuclear weapons becoming acceptable as the only way out. We can argue that Soviet intent to rule the world is neither demonstrable nor realistic, that domination of its immediate border areas is quite distinct from the rest of the world, as evidenced by the Yugoslav experience, as well as by Italian, French, Spanish, and other Communist parties' rejection of the Soviet version of internationalism. But we shouldn't be only defensive. We should show the significance of the best of American traditions for the future of socialism, particularly our deep-rooted belief that people must have strong protections against oppression by government bureaucracy. Herein lies the optimistic interpretation, the one we should emphasize, of the past 2 years' CIA revelations. Indeed, of the 15 years from the Civil Rights Movement through the Vietnam War and Watergate. Here, we can see genuine popular traditions that must be preserved and cultivated while casting off the institutions of the past that serve only a small elite. We must also defend against the false dilemma that either we move forward within traditional institutions or we destroy the nation. Neither the Russian, nor Chinese, nor any other nation was destroyed in their socialist revolutions, although certain privileged groups did disappear as groups. Quite the contrary, in spite of the human cost that in any case would compare favorably with the early generations of ordinary people under colonialism and industrial capitalism. National survival, in fact, isn't the question. It's whether the old dominance by capitalists will drag all of us down to dangerous and bitter isolation, or whether the United States, under socialist leadership, can effectively transfer its wealth of technology, capital, and other resources for the benefit of all. Our opponents will always try to confuse their class survival by equating it with national survival. When we read of national security and survival in various reports on the CIA and the FBI, we're reading about their security and survival, not ours. Those are their security services, not ours. It's their class security that they equate with the nation's survival. Probably not even Marx himself could have imagined the kind of public debate within the ruling class over security services that would demonstrate so clearly the nature of class struggle. Here we've read of cobra venom, poison dart guns, electronic eavesdropping, provocation of violence, all done by security services for a class that now rebukes those services for having acted illegally. The rebuke is mild. 20 years of crimes and not one indictment, but significant nonetheless. All in all, these investigations have been a ruling class affair. In analyzing the positive side of the past 15 years, however, we ought not to credit spasms of conscience among decision makers. Spontaneous popular pressure forced their decisions to retreat first here and then there, not overlooking, of course, the determination and heroism demonstrated by the national liberation movements in Vietnam, Cuba, Angola, and so many other places. But aside from ideology, we have learned an immense amount of specific information that will serve for future defense and protection when repression is intensified and the old methods are applied once again. Psychological distractions aside, the various reports make extremely fascinating reading, despite frequent repetitions, and they must be valued as the result of the first significant investigation of American intelligence, and the last for many years to come. Taken altogether, they constitute a treasure of information on institutionalized counter-revolution and should be read and studied by every political activist. We ought to assume that what is said in these reports is probably true, although from what is not said, we also have much to learn. First, the cost in people and money. None of the reports reveals how many people are employed in the U.S. intelligence effort, although the Department of Defense had over 100,000 people working in intelligence at the end of fiscal year 1975, with the trend markedly downward. Adding personnel of the FBI's counterintelligence efforts, the CIA, National Security Agency, counterintelligence components of the Department of State, the Department of the Treasury, and the Drug Enforcement Administration, the total might pass 150,000, although the Senate committee report mentions hundreds of thousands of people. None of the reports mentions explicitly the overall total of money spent on American intelligence activities, nor do they reveal how much the CIA or the NSA, for example, spend. These omissions reflect a considerable victory for President Ford, inasmuch as all the investigating commissions in varying degrees recommended giving the public some idea of what intelligence costs the country. Ford fought against disclosure of even the grand total for all intelligence on the ludicrous argument put forth by the CIA that extrapolations could lead the KGB to discovery of the CIA's capabilities. The House of Representatives Committee under Congressman Otis Pike found that the total intelligence budget is more than $10 billion, which is, quote, 3 to 4 times more costly than the Congress has been told, end quote, and possibly 5 times more. We get a hint, however, of the overall intelligence cost in the Senate committee's report. In each place where the amounts spent on intelligence and their percentage as a part of the federal budget were mentioned, the figures were deleted, except once where, apparently by clerical oversight, the overall national strategic intelligence cost is said to represent about 3% of the total federal budget for fiscal year 1976. In dollars, this would amount to about $11.2 billion and would include the total approved budgets of the CIA, DIA, NSA, and National Reconnaissance Office. However, according to the Senate committee, adding tactical intelligence and indirect support costs would double the amount spent on intelligence to $22.4 billion. As to what portion of the intelligence budget is spent by the CIA alone, the Senate committee's report also gives some clues. Item, quote, the DCI, Director of Central Intelligence, controls less than 10% of the combined national and tactical intelligence efforts, end quote. Item, quote, real executive authority over at least 4/5 of the total resources spent on intelligence activities has resided with the Secretary of Defense, end quote. Item, the Department of Defense, quote, controls nearly 90% of the nation's spending on intelligence programs, end quote. Thus, the CIA would be spending between $1 and $2 billion, depending on whether one takes the combined national, tactical, and indirect support costs as the total, or simply the national program, $11.2 billion as the total. According to the Senate committee's report, the buying power of the intelligence budget has been steadily decreasing since the mid-1960s, even though the budget itself, due to inflation, has been increasing in numbers of dollars spent. In 1976, according to the report, the buying power, in real terms, is about equal to the intelligence budgets of the late 1950s. How is the money divided among the target countries? Quote, nearly 2/3 of the fiscal year 1975 resources consumed, 65 cents of each dollar, were directed toward the Soviet Union and U.S. commitments to NATO. 25 cents of each dollar were spent to support U.S. interests in Asia, with most of this targeted against China. The Arab-Israeli confrontation in the Middle East claimed 7 cents, Latin America less than 2 cents, and the rest of the world about a penny, end quote. Predominance of technical intelligence programs is evident. The Commission Investigating Government Organization for Foreign Affairs, established in 1972 under the veteran State Department troubleshooter Robert D. Murphy, stated in its final report in mid-1975, quote, "Today, the bulk of information comes from open sources, overhead reconnaissance, and electronic signals and communications, with only a small but possibly critical component derived from clandestine sources," end quote. The Senate committee's report is more specific. Quote, "Approximately 87% of the resources devoted to collection is spent on technical sensors, compared to only 13% for HUMINT," end quote, traditional undercover agents and overt human sources. The committee concludes, however, that in intelligence, as elsewhere, machines cannot completely replace men. Quote, "The United States cannot forego clandestine human collection and expect to maintain the same quality of intelligence on matters of the highest importance to our national security," end quote. This statement accurately reflects the CIA's traditional concern that too often only humans can report on secret intentions. As an aid to the CIA's critical HUMINT program, it seems the tradition of plying people with booze is still as strong as ever. The House committee reported that one typical, medium-sized CIA station, quote, "spent $86,000 in liquor and cigarettes during the past 5 years. The majority of these purchases were designated operational gifts, gifts to friendly agents or officials in return for information or assistance," end quote. At another unnamed CIA station, the Pike Committee reports $41,000 were spent on liquor in 1971, and that station chief, since transferred, is now in charge of CIA operations in Angola, i.e., during the doomed CIA South African intervention in the 1975 Civil War. One must hope that this officer will now be placed in charge of the CIA's operations in Namibia or Zimbabwe. We discover, then, confirmation that the overhead reconnaissance programs and the other technical collection operations, mainly the NSA's SIGINT programs for interception and analysis of communications and electronic emissions, devour the lion's share of the national intelligence budget. Analysis and preparation of finished reports also receives appropriate emphasis, as does the CIA's counterintelligence efforts against other security services, which are largely a part of the overall HUMINT program. Not overlooked, however, in the Senate, House, and Murphy Commission reports is the continuing need to rely on the most controversial of the CIA's activities, covert action. The Murphy Commission defines covert action as, quote, "activity abroad intended not to gather information, but to influence events, an activity midway between diplomacy and war. It has taken many forms, from the financial support of friendly publications to the mounting of significant paramilitary efforts," end quote. Similarly, the Pike Committee defines covert action as, quote, "activity other than purely information gathering, which is directed at producing a particular political, economic, or military result," end quote. Senator Church's committee describes covert action as, quote, "the secret use of power and persuasion," end quote, and as, quote, "clandestine activity designed to influence foreign governments, events, organizations, or persons in support of U.S. foreign policy conducted in such a way that the involvement of the U.S. government is not apparent," end quote. Covert action operations in the Senate report include, quote, "political and propaganda programs designed to influence or support foreign political parties, groups, and specific political and military leaders, economic action programs, paramilitary operations, and some counterinsurgency programs, human intelligence collection or spying, and counterespionage programs are not included under the rubric of covert action operations," end quote. Expressed still another way, covert action is the way the CIA uses the information it collects in order to penetrate and manipulate the institutions of power in a given country, i.e., the military services and political parties, the security services, the trade unions, youth and student organizations, cultural and professional societies, and the public information media. Covert action is the way the CIA props up and strengthens the friendlies and disrupts, divides, weakens, and destroys the enemies. Covert action, then, is the American euphemism for subversion and counter-revolution. Both the Senate and the House committees questioned the CIA's statutory authority to engage in covert action, since no explicit power for such operations was granted to the agency in pertinent legislation, such as the National Security Act of 1947 and its amendment, the Central Intelligence Agency Act of 1949. Successive administrations since covert action began in 1948 have justified these operations on the vaguely worded authority in the 1947 law for the CIA to, quote, perform such other functions and duties related to intelligence affecting the national security as the National Security Council may from time to time direct, end quote. Nevertheless, only when the Hughes-Ryan Amendment to the Foreign Assistance Act was passed in 1974 did the Congress recognize the legitimacy of covert action. This amendment required the president to report to six congressional subcommittees, quote, in a timely fashion, end quote, the scope and description of all covert action operations, and to certify that each such operation is important to the national security of the United States. Besides extending congressional control over covert action and legitimizing it, this amendment also, not unintentionally, killed the old doctrine of plausible denial, wherein presidents could plead ignorance of covert action, operations that became blown. The report of the Senate Committee, Book 1, contains a most useful background section on the history of the CIA, and particularly on the attitudes of leading American government figures at the beginning of the Cold War. Frequent repetition of these themes highlighting the Soviet international communist threat as the early justification for covert action operations suggests their persistence in the thought patterns of those who drafted the current Senate report, as we shall see when covert action is recommended for the future. Quote, the Second World War saw the defeat of one brand of totalitarianism. A new totalitarian challenge quickly arose. The Soviet Union, a major ally in war, became America's principal adversary in peace. The power of fascism was in ruin, but the power of communism was mobilized. Not only had the communist parties in France, Italy, and Greece emerged politically strengthened by their roles in the resistance, but the armies of the Soviet Union stretched across the center of Europe. Following the war, there was a distinct possibility of a Soviet assault on Western Europe. Communist regimes had been established in Poland, Hungary, Romania, and Bulgaria. Czechoslovakia went communist in 1948 through a coup supported by the Russian army. There was the presence of the Soviet army in Eastern Europe and the pressure on Berlin. By late 1946, cabinet officials were preoccupied with the Soviet threat, and over the next year, their fears intensified. For U.S. policymakers, international events seemed to be a sequence of Soviet incursions. Communist gains are cited in Iran, Greece, Poland, Hungary, Romania, the Philippines, Czechoslovakia, France, and Italy. Policymakers could and did look at these developments as evidence of the need for the United States to respond. End quote. The CIA's covert action operations are everywhere, seen in these reports as a response to the Soviet threat looming either directly or through national communist parties. The first covert action arm of the CIA, the Office of Policy Coordination, was established in 1948 by a directive that also referred to the, quote, vicious covert activities of the USSR, end quote. OPC was authorized to engage in, quote, covert political, psychological, and economic warfare. These early activities were directed against the Soviet threat. They included countering Soviet propaganda and covert Soviet support of labor unions and student groups in Western Europe, direct U.S. support of foreign political parties, economic warfare, sabotage, assistance to refugee liberation groups, and support of anti-communist groups in occupied or threatened areas, end quote. Still another precise description, quote, Psychological operations were primarily media-related activities, including unattributed publications, forgeries, and subsidization of publications. Political action involved exploitation of dispossessed persons and defectors and support to political parties. Paramilitary activities included support to guerrillas and sabotage. Economic activities consisted of monetary and fiscal operations. End quote. Perhaps the best description of the attitude during the early Cold War is this Churchillian passage from the 1954 investigation of intelligence organization under the Hoover Commission. Quote, "It is now clear that we are facing an implacable enemy whose avowed objective is world domination by whatever means and at whatever cost. There are no rules in such a game. Hitherto acceptable norms of human conduct do not apply. If the U.S. is to survive, long-standing concepts of fair play must be reconsidered. We must develop effective espionage and counter-espionage services. We must learn to subvert, sabotage, and destroy our enemies by more clever, more sophisticated, and more effective methods than those used against us. It may become necessary that the American people will be made acquainted with, understand, and support this fundamentally repugnant philosophy." End quote. No attempt is made in any of the reports to evaluate, with the benefit of hindsight, the validity of U.S. fears of the Soviet Union following World War II. Neither is there any suggestion that Soviet actions may have been a response to aggressive CIA operations. We find little evaluation of the early CIA operations directed against Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union, except that some of the more provocative actions ended in the mid-1950s. Indirect admission of failure is evident in the discussion of the CIA's expansion of paramilitary operations in the Far East during the Korean War. Quote, "During this period, the CIA's Office of Procurement acquired some $152 million worth of foreign weapons and ammunition for use by guerrilla forces that never came into existence." End quote. Nevertheless, the Deputy Directorate of Plans, also known as the Clandestine Services, which was in charge of the CIA's clandestine collection and counterintelligence programs and its covert action operations, came to dominate the agency. Covert action operations also came to dominate the agency's operational patterns around the world, no doubt in response to National Security Council directives such as this one, which ordered the CIA to, quote, "create and exploit problems for international communism, discredit international communism, and reduce the strength of its parties and organization, reduce international communist control over any areas of the world," end quote. Covert action operations not only became the major instrument in the American foreign policy goal to, quote, "roll back the Iron Curtain," end quote, quote, "covert action soon became a routine program of influencing governments and covertly exercising power, involving literally hundreds of projects each year. By 1953, there were major covert operations underway in 48 countries, consisting of propaganda, paramilitary, and political action projects. By the 1960s, covert action had come to mean any clandestine activity designed to influence foreign governments, events, organizations, or persons in support of United States foreign policy. Several thousand individual covert action projects have been undertaken since 1961. End quote. One project, the report fails to make clear, can go on for many years, as long as renewals are approved. Quote, "The committee has found that the CIA has conducted some 900 major or sensitive covert action projects, plus several thousand smaller projects since 1961. End quote. Since the revelations of CIA covert action operations sparked by Ramparts magazine in 1967, these activities have decreased. Quote, "The period 1968 to the present has registered declines in every functional and geographic category of covert action, except for paramilitary operations in the Far East, which did not drop until 1972. The number of individual covert action projects dropped by 50% from fiscal year 1964, when they reached an all-time high, to fiscal year 1968, end quote. Nevertheless, covert action has by no means ended. Quote, "Yet the overall reduction did not affect the fundamental assumptions, organization, and incentives governing the DDO, the new name for Deputy Director of Operations, the Clandestine Services. Indeed, in 1975, clandestine activities still constituted 37% of the agency's total budget. The rationale remains the same, and the operational capability is intact, as the CIA activities in Chile illustrated, end quote. 37% of the agency's budget provides hundreds of millions of dollars for current covert action operations. As the Senate Committee's report points out, quote, the number of projects by itself is not an adequate measure of the scope of covert action. Projects can vary considerably in size, cost, duration, and effect. Today, for example, 1/4 of the current covert action projects are relatively high cost, over $100,000 annually, end quote. Both the Church and the Pike Committee's reports are replete with information on general categories of the CIA's operations and on specific operations as well. Both committees studied specific covert action projects in detail, the Church Committee reviewing these operations over the past 25 years, and the Pike Committee reviewing all projects approved by the 40 Committee, the group chaired by the President's National Security Advisor, with participation by the Undersecretary of State and the Deputy Secretary of Defense during the past 10 years. The Pike Committee found that since 1965, the largest category of individual covert action projects requiring approval outside the CIA, 32%, was for financial election support to foreign politicians and political parties. 29% of 40 committee approvals during the same period were for media and propaganda projects, while 23% were for military activities, secret armies, financial support to warring factions, training and advisors, and shipment of arms and ammunition. The Pike Committee also found that, quote, a plethora of foreign civic, religious, professional, and labor organizations have received CIA funding without special geographical concentration, but with plenty of third world emphasis, end quote. In the 900 major or sensitive covert action projects discovered by the Church Committee, together with several thousand smaller projects undertaken since 1961, funds were provided for, quote, a seemingly limitless range of covert action programs affecting youth groups, labor unions, universities, publishing houses, and other private institutions in the United States and abroad, end quote. A former station chief in one country where covert action programs were heavy and persistent testified to the Senate committee that, quote, any aspiring politician almost automatically would come to CIA to see if we could help him get elected. They were the wards of the United States, and that whatever happened, for good or bad, was the fault of the United States, end quote. In the media field, the Pike Committee reported that, quote, by far the largest single recipient has been a unnamed European publishing house funded since 1951, end quote. For its part, the Church Committee revealed that prior to 1967, the CIA had, quote, sponsored, subsidized, or produced over 1,000 books, approximately 25% of them in English. In 1967 alone, the CIA published or subsidized over 200 books, ranging from books on African safaris and wildlife to translations of Machiavelli's The Prince into Swahili and works of T.S. Eliot into Russian, to a competitor to Mao's Little Red Book, which was entitled Quotations from Chairman Liu, end quote. Among the books was the fabricated Penkovsky Papers, supposedly based on writings of the famous Russian spy. The importance of books is recognized in the CIA, as in this passage from a memorandum written in 1961 by the chief of the covert action staff, quote, books differ from other propaganda media, primarily because one single book can significantly change the reader's attitude and action to an extent unmatched by the impact of any other single medium, end quote. For this reason, presumably, the CIA has continued to publish books, although it apparently ceased publishing in the U.S. in 1967 following the major scandal relating to the CIA's penetration of domestic institutions, especially the National Student Association. The CIA since then, quote, has published some 250 books abroad, most of them in foreign languages, end quote. The church committee reveals that the agency continues to penetrate the journalistic profession. Quote, the CIA currently maintains a network of several hundred foreign individuals who provide the CIA with direct access to a large number of newspapers and periodicals, scores of press services and news agencies, radio and television stations, commercial book publishers, and other foreign media outlets, end quote. Concerning U.S. journalists, quote, approximately 50 of the assets are American journalists or employees of U.S. media organizations, end quote, with about half of these accredited and the rest freelance. In early 1978, the CIA asserted its need for continued utilization of journalists on a, quote, voluntary basis, end quote. Orchestration of propaganda through these journalist agents is illustrated by this extract from a CIA cable dated September 25, 1970, relating to propaganda against the Allende election. Quote, Sao Paulo, Tegucigalpa, Buenos Aires, Lima, Montevideo, Bogota, Mexico City report continued replay of Chile theme materials. Items also carried in New York Times and Washington Post. Propaganda activities continue to generate good coverage of Chile developments along our theme guidance, end quote. Religious organizations, clergy, and missionaries have long been used by the CIA both for intelligence collection and for covert action. The CIA committee reports, quote, direct operational use of 21 individuals, end quote, in this field who were Americans. And although the CIA in February 1976 renounced any, quote, secret paid or contractual relationship, end quote, with American missionaries or members of the clergy, the agency's use of foreigners in this field presumably will continue. The most important general category of covert action operations, about which very little is said in these reports, is the trade union field. CIA programs in national and international labor unions were vast in scope during the 1950s and 1960s, and the lack of serious discussion of them in the Senate and House committees' reports is, to me, a very strong indicator that the agency continues to be quite active promoting moderate, non-political, docile trade unions. The only significant mention of labor operations in the Pike report is the brief statement that, quote, one labor confederation in a developing country received an annual subsidy of $30,000 in three successive years, end quote. The Church report simply mentions that prior to the 1967 scandals, the agency had employed, quote, the cooperation of an American labor organization in selected overseas labor activities, end quote. The report goes on to reveal that after the tightening up in the wake of the 1967 scandals, the agency decided to continue to fund, quote, several international trade union organizations, end quote. Aside from suggesting the continuing importance of the CIA's labor operations, these scant references say quite a lot about senators and congresspersons' deference to the electoral importance of George Meany, the president of the American Federation of Labor, and from the beginning, the CIA's Mr. Big in labor operations. American academics get high marks from the Senate Committee on their cooperation with the CIA, which, quote, is now using several hundred American academics who, in addition to providing leads and sometimes making introductions for intelligence purposes, occasionally write books and other material to be used for propaganda purposes abroad. These academics are located in over 100 American colleges, universities, and related institutes. The committee notes that American academics provide valuable assistance for obtaining leads on potential foreign intelligence sources, especially those from communist countries who are among the many foreign nationals in the United States, end quote. In paramilitary operations, the Church Committee confirms CIA participation in the overthrow of Arbenz in Guatemala in 1954 and in attempts to overthrow Sukarno in Indonesia in 1958, as well as similar operations in Korea, Vietnam, Cuba, and Laos. In a critical vein, however, the committee finds that, quote, of the five paramilitary activities studied by the committee, only one appears to have achieved its objectives. The goal of supporting a central government was achieved. The same government is still in power many years later. There were a few sporadic reports of the operation in the press, but it was never fully revealed or confirmed, end quote. Even so, quote, in no paramilitary case studied by the committee was complete secrecy fully preserved, end quote. One's thoughts run immediately to the Congo Zaire of the early 1960s when considering which success the church committee means, especially when a couple of paragraphs later, testimony is cited on the difficulty of withdrawing from paramilitary operations once started. Quote, this is well illustrated by the case of the Congo, where a decision was taken to withdraw in early 1966, and it took about a year and a half before the operation was terminated, end quote. The key figure in the CIA's successful Congo Zaire paramilitary operations of the 1960s was, of course, Colonel Joseph Mobutu, now known as President Mobutu Sese Seko. Could Mobutu also be the unnamed third world leader who received $960,000 over a 14-year period, according to the Pike Committee report? Not many others have survived for 14 years. No matter, the Pike Committee's revelation is sure to sour the CIA's relations with other third world leaders whose bribes may only have totaled a few hundred thousand dollars. Two major CIA paramilitary operations are described by the House of Representatives Committee: support to the Kurdish nationalist movement in Iraq in 1972 through 1975, and support to the Holden Roberto and Jonas Savimbi factions in the 1975 civil war in Angola. In order to cause problems for Iraq, the Shah of Iran, who was engaged in a border dispute with Iraq, asked Dr. Kissinger and President Nixon for U.S. participation in his program of support to the Kurds, led by Mustafa Barzani, who were then in armed rebellion against the Iraqi central government. Eventually, some $16 million was spent by the CIA on this operation, only a fraction of what the Shah spent, but valued by the Shah and Barzani both for its symbolic importance and to Barzani as a guarantee against any sudden cutoff of the Shah's aid. According to the committee, the U.S. aid was also undertaken, quote, as a favor to our ally, the Shah, who had cooperated with U.S. intelligence agencies, the CIA, and had come to feel menaced by his neighbor, Iraq, end quote. Barzani, on numerous occasions, expressed his distrust of the Shah's intentions, and he showed his appreciation to Kissinger by sending him three rugs and, when Kissinger married, a gold and pearl necklace. Nevertheless, the aid was not meant to provide for a final Kurdish victory and the limited autonomy that Barzani had fought for since the 1920s. Quote, the United States personally restrained the insurgents from an all-out offensive on one occasion when such an attack might have been successful, end quote. In early 1975, as soon as the Shah got his border concessions from Iraq, he cut off aid to the Kurds, and the CIA did too. The cutoff came as a severe shock. Quote, a CIA cable from the COS, probably in Tehran, to the CIA director describes the method used by our ally, the Shah, to inform the ethnic groups, the Kurds, leadership. On March 5th, a representative of our ally's intelligence service, no doubt the dreaded Sabak secret police, visited the headquarters of the ethnic group and told them in the bluntest imaginable terms that the border was being closed, that assistance had ended, and that the Kurds should settle with the Iraqis on whatever terms they could get, end quote. The Iraqis, knowing of the cutoff, took the offensive and eliminated Kurdish resistance. In the aftermath, 200,000 Kurdish refugees were created, but despite pleas from Barzani, the U.S. refused to extend humanitarian assistance. The Shah forcibly repatriated to Iraq over 40,000 Kurds who sought refuge in Iran, and the U.S. refused to admit even one Kurdish refugee, even though they qualified for admittance as political asylees. As one high U.S. official told the Pike Committee staff, quote, covert action should not be confused with missionary work, end quote. The Angolan intervention by the CIA, though widely reported, is clarified in the Pike Committee report. Support for the Holden Roberto group began in January 1975, and in mid-summer, support for the Savimbi forces began. The House committee concludes that the Soviet-Cuban buildup to help the MPLA which the Soviets had supported for 10 years against Portuguese colonialism, came as a reaction to the startling gains of the Roberto and Savimbi forces, thanks to the $31 million worth of assistance pumped in by the CIA. As to the reasons for the U.S. getting involved, CIA Director William Colby could find scant ideological differences among the three groups, quote, all of whom are nationalists above all else, end quote, according to the committee. Responding to committee questions, Colby said, quote, they are all independents. They are all for black Africa. They are all for some fuzzy kind of social system, you know, without really much articulation, but some sort of let's not be exploited by the capitalist system, end quote. Quote, Mr. Aspen, a committee member, and why are the Chinese backing the moderate group? Mr. Colby, because the Soviets are backing the MPLA is the simplest answer. Mr. Aspen, it sounds like that is why we are doing it. Mr. Colby, it is, end quote. Another reason, the committee concluded, was Kissinger's desire to encourage moderate independence groups in southern Africa and the stability of such figures as Mobutu, who supported Roberto, and President Kaunda of Zambia, who supported Savimbi. Quote, past U.S. support to Mobutu, along with his responsiveness to some of the United States' recent diplomatic needs for third world support, make it equally likely that the paramount factor in U.S. involvement is Dr. Kissinger's desire to reward and protect African leaders in the area, end quote. The most complete account of any major CIA covert action operation is the Senate Committee's separate 62-page report on operations in Chile from 1963 to 1973. It is unique as an official account of the many secret methods used by three successive American administrations to prevent the Chilean people from exercising their right to choose their own political leadership. Altogether, over $13 million was spent, and this money, if calculated at its black market buying power, may well have had an impact equivalent to three or four times as much. Great detail makes this report exceedingly important, not only as a clarification of what happened in Chile, but for its value in analyzing future destabilization operations and defeating them. It's all there. Millions of dollars to the non-left political parties, mainly the Christian Democrats, huge amounts also to El Mercurio, the media giant, financial support to the truckers who paralyzed the economy in 1972 and 1973, financial support to the right-wing terrorist organization, Patria y Libertad, economic squeeze through retention of credits, both by private institutions and through U.S. dominance of the multilateral agencies, CIA weapons to a group planning the assassination of Army General Schneider in order to provoke a military coup, ITT's offer of $1 million to the CIA for use against the 1970 Allende campaign and its later spending, with CIA assistance and participation by other U.S. companies, of some $700,000 in the campaign. Finally, the revolting but logical CIA support for the security services of the Pinochet regime. The CIA's political intervention in Italy over the years has been more successful in that its clients, principally the Christian Democrats, but also the neo-fascists, have managed to retain power, if only just, for almost 30 years. The Pike Committee report describes how the CIA has spent some $75 million in Italian political campaigns since 1948, with $10 million spent in the 1972 elections alone. Of more importance, perhaps, was the CIA's passage of $800,000 to General Vito Micheli, former head of Italian military intelligence and a leader of the neo-fascist MSI. Micheli, at the time, 1972, was awaiting trial, he still is, for his part in the 1970 right-wing coup plot known as the Borghese Affair. Although the CIA opposed giving Micheli the money, spending of which was uncontrolled, but supposedly for propaganda activities, American Ambassador Graham Martin insisted and prevailed in order, quote, to demonstrate solidarity with Micheli for the long pull, end quote. Martin went on to preside over the final collapse in South Vietnam. Not included in the Pike Committee report, but certainly worth recalling, is the decision by President Ford, leaked to journalists in early January 1976, approving during the previous month the spending by the CIA of some $6 million between then and the next Italian general elections. Indicative also of Ford and Kissinger thinking on the long pull in Italy was the visit in late September 1975 of neo-fascist leader Giorgio Almirante to Washington, where, among other activities, he met with staff members of the National Security Council, the body chaired by the president that governs the CIA. Perhaps with Italy in mind, the Church Committee warned that, quote, covert action techniques within or against a foreign society can have unintended consequences that sometimes subvert long-term goals. For instance, extended covert support to foreign political leaders, parties, labor unions, or the media has not always accomplished the intended objective of strengthening them against the communist challenge. In some cases, it has both encouraged a debilitating dependence on United States covert support and made those receiving such support vulnerable to repudiation in their own society when the covert ties are exposed, end quote. As if in longing for the good old days, the Senate committee concluded, quote, some covert operations have passed retrospective public judgments, such as the support given Western European Democratic parties facing strong communist opposition in the later 1940s and 1950s. Others have not. In the view of the committee, the covert harassment of the democratically elected government of Salvador Allende in Chile did not command U.S. public approval, end quote. In a similar vein, the Senate committee laments two other grisly CIA programs, assassinations against foreign leaders, quote, an aberration, end quote, and the use of biological and chemical agents against people, quote, massive abridgments of the rights of American citizens, end quote. The 350-page assassination report contains a massive amount of data, including extracts from previously secret internal CIA communications on the agency's involvement in attempts to assassinate five foreign leaders. Patrice Lumumba. In 1960, the CIA sent assassins and poison to the Congo in order to kill Lumumba, but appropriate access to the Congolese leader was never obtained. Nevertheless, the CIA had foreknowledge of Mobutu's plans to deliver Lumumba to his enemies in Katanga in January 1961, and knew that Lumumba would most probably be assassinated by those enemies. The Senate committee concludes, quote, there is no evidence of CIA involvement in this plan or in bringing about the death of Lumumba in Katanga, end quote. As background, the Senate report states the problem, quote, in the summer of 1960, there was great concern at the highest levels in the United States government about the role of Patrice Lumumba in the Congo. Lumumba, who served briefly as premier of the newly independent nation, was viewed with alarm by United States policymakers because of what they perceived as his magnetic public appeal and his leanings toward the Soviet Union. In mid-September, after losing a struggle for leadership of the government to Kasavubu and Joseph Mobutu, chief of staff of the Congolese Armed Forces, Lumumba sought protection from the United Nations forces in Leopoldville. Early in December, Mobutu's troops captured Lumumba, transferred Lumumba to Katanga province. Several weeks later, Katangan authorities announced Lumumba's death, end quote. Meanwhile, the CIA's plotting to assassinate Lumumba had proceeded following, quote, President Eisenhower's strong expression of concern about Lumumba at a meeting of the National Security Council on August 18, 1960, which was taken by Alan Dulles as authority to assassinate Lumumba. Indeed, one NSC staff member present at the August 18th meeting believed that he witnessed a presidential order to assassinate Lumumba, end quote. The report is unclear on how much the CIA helped Mobutu to capture Lumumba during the period between his escape from UN custody on November 27, 1960, and his capture on December 3rd. A November 28th cable reads, quote, station working with Congolese government to get roads blocked and troops alerted to block possible escape route, end quote. Nevertheless, a CIA officer at Leopoldville at the time, Victor Hedgman, testified to the committee that he, Hedgman, was, quote, not a major assistance, end quote, in tracking down Lumumba. The committee could find no evidence that the CIA was behind the decision to turn Lumumba over to Kanangan authorities, although up to the time of the turnover on January 17, 1961, the CIA, quote, was convinced that drastic steps were necessary to prevent Lumumba's return to power, end quote. At the very same time, Mobutu himself was on the verge of being overthrown by a mutiny of the Leopoldville garrison, which, according to a CIA cable, quote, will mutiny within 2 or 3 days unless drastic action taken to satisfy complaints, end quote. The UN report written in the aftermath of Lumumba's assassination mentioned others, followers of Lumumba, who had been delivered by Mobutu to Katanga and who, quote, were killed there in horrible circumstances, end quote. Knowing of these precedents, the CIA station in Katanga, Elizabethville, could scarcely conceal its glee on learning of Lumumba's delivery by Mobutu. In a cable to Washington, the CIA chief in Katanga paraphrased a popular song of the time, joked, quote, thanks for Patrice. If we had known he was coming, we would have baked a snake, end quote. Fidel Castro. The Senate committee found, quote, concrete evidence of at least 8 plots involving the CIA to assassinate Fidel Castro from 1960 to 1965. Although some of the assassination plots did not go beyond the stage of planning and preparation, one plot, involving the use of underworld figures, reportedly twice progressed to the point of sending poison pills to Cuba and dispatching teams to commit the deed. Another plot involved furnishing weapons and other assassination devices to a Cuban dissident. The proposed assassination devices ran the gamut from high-powered rifles to poison pills, poison pens, deadly bacterial powders, and other devices. End quote. Quote, the most ironic of these plots took place on November 22, 1963, the very day that President Kennedy was shot in Dallas, when a CIA official offered a poison pen to a Cuban for use against Castro, while at the same time, an emissary from President Kennedy was meeting with Castro to explore the possibility of improved relations, end quote. Other plots were designed to ruin Castro's image, to spray his broadcasting studio with a chemical that produces effects similar to LSD, to dust his shoes with a strong depilatory that would make his beard fall out, already tested on animals, to give Castro cigars impregnated with a chemical that produces temporary disorientation. Other plots to assassinate Castro involved giving him a box of his favorite cigars contaminated with botulinum toxin, quote, so potent that a person would die after putting one in his mouth, end quote. Another would use an exotic seashell rigged to explode in an area where Castro commonly went skin diving. Other targets of assassination in Cuba, one would have assumed, were Raul Castro and Che Guevara. Rafael Trujillo. From the spring of 1960 until Trujillo's assassination on May 30, 1961, the CIA was in contact with political dissidents, at least some of whom affected the assassination. Although 3 pistols and 3 carbines were passed to the dissidents, the Senate committee could not find, quote, direct evidence that the weapons which were passed were used in the assassination, end quote. Although there was no doubt that the dissidents intended to assassinate Trujillo and the weapons were given for that purpose, an attempt was made to cover up U.S. government sponsorship. Quote, the day before the assassination, a cable, personally authorized by President Kennedy, was sent to the United States Consul General in the Dominican Republic, stating that the United States government, as a matter of general policy, could not condone political assassination, but at the same time indicating that the United States continued to support the dissidents and stood ready to recognize them in the event that they were successful in their endeavor to overthrow Trujillo, end quote. According to the Senate report, American desire to eliminate Trujillo was partly a public relations concern and partly fear of another Cuba. Quote, he was regarded throughout much of the Caribbean and Latin America as a protege of the United States. Trujillo's rule, always harsh and dictatorial, became more arbitrary during the 1950s. As a result, the United States' image was increasingly tarnished in the eyes of many Latin Americans. Increasingly, American awareness of Trujillo's brutality and fear that it would lead to a Castro-style revolution
caused United States officials to consider various plans to hasten his abdication or downfall, end quote. Had Trujillo survived only a few years, he would have had plenty of support and company, starting with the Brazilian generals in 1964 and followed by the other harsh right-wing regimes promoted by the CIA in Latin America later in the 1960s and 1970s. General René Schneider. As a constitutionalist and commander of the Chilean army, General Schneider was a principal obstacle to the CIA's attempts to prevent Salvador Allende from taking office after his election. Schneider was shot resisting a kidnapping attempt on October 22nd, and he died 3 days later. The Senate committee found that, quote, the United States government supported and sought to instigate a military coup to block Allende. U.S. officials, CIA and U.S. Army attaché, supplied financial aid, machine guns, and other equipment to various military figures who opposed Allende. Although the CIA continued to support the coup plotters up to Schneider's shooting, it does not appear that any of the equipment supplied by the CIA to coup plotters in Chile was used in the kidnapping, end quote. In fact, the report states, quote, the CIA had withdrawn active support of the group which carried out the actual kidnap attempt on October 22nd, end quote. Again, the Senate committee is very careful to separate the intent of the CIA and U.S. policymakers by distinguishing the policy of assassination from the act as it finally occurred. Ngo Dinh Diem. Diem, the South Vietnamese dictator, and his brother Nguyen were assassinated during a general's coup on November 2, 1963. The committee found that, quote, although the United States supported the coup, there is no evidence that American officials favored the assassination. Indeed, it appears that the assassination of Diem was not part of the general's pre-coup planning, but instead was a spontaneous act, end quote. Aside from these five specific cases studied by the Senate committee, evidence was also discovered that during the early 1960s, the CIA established an assassination capability, termed executive action in the agency, for general purpose targeting. The agency cryptonym was ZR Rifle. Quote, in general, Project ZR Rifle involved assessing the problems and requirements of assassination and developing a standby assassination capability. More specifically, it involved spotting potential agents and researching assassination techniques that might be used, end quote. The committee found no new plots that might have come under authority of this project, but the project was eventually merged with other efforts underway to assassinate Fidel Castro. It is important to place the CIA assassination plots within the larger context of covert action operations and policy goals in the countries concerned. As the report points out, in all five cases of CIA involvement, the principal figures were impediments to American policy goals. That Castro survived, or that the others may not have been killed directly by the CIA, in no way detracts from the importance of these revelations and the value of the Senate report. The Senate committee's findings are also rich in detail on the CIA's programs for testing and using chemical and biological agents, which at certain times overlapped with similar programs of the U.S. Army. Although these programs apparently started with defense against possible hostile chemical or biological attack in mind, the committee found that, quote, soon this defensive orientation became secondary as the possibility of using these chemical and biological agents to obtain information from or to gain control of enemy agents became apparent, end quote. As early as 1947, the U.S. Navy began research into the possible speech-inducing drugs such as scopolamine and mescaline, Project Chatter. The CIA followed with a variety of programs beginning with Project Bluebird in 1950, renamed Project Artichoke in 1951, in which interrogations were conducted overseas using psychiatric examinations, sodium pentothal, and hypnosis. MK Naomi was a joint CIA-Army project to stockpile severely incapacitating and lethal biological and chemical materials and the means for their application. This program lasted from 1952 to 1970 and included development of poison darts and dart guns, not only for killing, but also for temporary incapacitation. One such gun could fire darts, quote, coated with a chemical that would incapacitate a guard dog in order to allow CIA agents to knock out the guard dog silently, enter an installation, and return the dog to consciousness when leaving, end quote. Sabotage of field crops was also a capability developed under MK Naomi, but perhaps the most sensational occurrence was the refusal of the CIA officer in charge of the project's shellfish toxin, approximately 11 grams, about one-third of the total world production and sufficient for tens of thousands of lethal darts, to destroy the poison when President Nixon so ordered in 1970. The scientist stored the toxin in a CIA laboratory where it went unnoticed for 5 years. The principal CIA chemical and biological program was MKUltra. This program, which lasted from 1953 through the late 1960s, was concerned with, quote, the research and development of chemical, biological, and radiological materials capable of employment in clandestine operations to control human behavior, end quote. Techniques included, quote, radiation, electroshock, various forms of psychology, psychiatry, sociology and anthropology, graphology, harassment substances, and paramilitary devices and materials, end quote. Testing occurred under both laboratory conditions and, quote, normal life settings, end quote, including the administering of drugs like LSD to unwitting subjects. At the Federal Drug Rehabilitation Center in Lexington, Kentucky, the CIA tested hallucinogenic drugs on addicts and, quote, as a reward for participation in the program, the addicts were provided with the drug of their addiction, end quote. The widely reported death of Dr. Frank Olson, an Army scientist who committed suicide from depression 8 days after being surreptitiously given LSD by the CIA, occurred under MKUltra. But in spite of Olson's death, the CIA continued to give LSD to unsuspecting victims for 10 more years. Thus, in order to observe the behavior of persons after taking the drug unwittingly, quote, the individual CIA officer conducting the test might make initial contact with a prospective subject selected at random in a bar. He would then invite the person to a safe house where the test drug was administered to the subject through drink or in food. CIA personnel might debrief the individual conducting the test or observe the test by using a one-way mirror and tape recorder in an adjoining room, end quote. In 1973, not surprisingly, CIA Director Richard Helms ordered that all MKUltra documents be destroyed. The U.S. Army also used LSD as an aid to interrogation in projects Third Chance and Darby Hat. One such interrogation appears in the committee report as an extract from the Army report. Quote, stressing techniques employed included silent treatment before or after LSD administration, sustained conventional interrogation prior to LSD interrogation, deprivation of food, drink, sleep, or bodily evacuation, sustained isolation prior to LSD administration, hot-cold switches in approach, duress pitches, verbal degradation and bodily discomfort, or dramatized threats to subjects' life or mental health, end quote. Another Army interrogation, this one using LSD on a suspected Asian espionage agent, is equally disturbing. Quote, at 11:20, sweating became evident. His pulse became thready. He was placed in a supine position. He began groaning with expiration and became semi-comatose. At 11:48, responses to painful stimuli were slightly improved. At 11:55, he was helped to a sitting position. At 1200, he became shocky again and was returned to supine position. At 1212, he was more alert and able to sit up with help. At 1220, subject was assisted to the interrogation table. At 1230, he began moaning he wanted to die and usually ignored questions. Rarely, he stated, quote, he didn't know, end quote. At 1250, his phasic alertness persisted. He frequently refocused his eyes with eyelid assistance. He frequently threw his head back with eyes closed. At 1330, he was slightly more alert. He was force-walked for 5 minutes. He physically would cooperate until he became shocky again, sweating, thready pulse, pale. The interrogation continued for 17.5 hours after the drug was administered. End quote. Just 3 years earlier, a staff study prepared in the Army unit responsible for these projects discussed the moral and legal aspects of using LSD in interrogations. Quote, "It was always a tenet of Army intelligence that the basic American principle of the dignity and welfare of the individual will not be violated. In intelligence, the stakes involved and the interests of national security may permit a more tolerant interpretation of moral ethical values. Any claim against the U.S. government for alleged injury due to LSD must be legally shown to have been due to the material." End quote. The problem of hypocrisy attendant upon the double standard and violation of professed principles is consistently present in the report of the Senate committee and is alluded to in the reports of the House committee, the Murphy Commission, and the Rockefeller Commission. The Murphy Commission, for example, concluded that new measures should be taken, quote, "to ensure that in both word and deed, our own foreign policy reflects devotion to high ethical standards," end quote. And, quote, "to ensure that due consideration is given to ethical arguments in the setting and carrying out of policy," end quote. Nevertheless, adds the report, quote, "the ethical responsibilities that man has to man and nation to nation, where neither recognized rights nor dramatic misfortunes are involved, are subtle and less certain," end quote, even though they, quote, "lie close to the heart of many current international differences, such as arms control and disarmament, including weapons design and strategic doctrine, problems of the redistribution of wealth, including terms of trade, and transfers of capital and technology, and food and population policies," end quote. Yet, in discussing the need for the CIA to continue covert action operations, the Murphy Commission is, quote, "realistic," end quote. Quote, "but we live in the world we find, not the world we might wish. Our adversaries deny themselves no forms of action which might advance their interests or undercut ours," end quote. The Senate committee also found that, quote, "many covert operations appear to violate our international treaty obligations and commitments, such as the charters of the United Nations and the Organization of American States," end quote. But it could not resolve this contradiction. Indeed, according to the American Constitution, treaties once ratified become, quote, "the law of the land," end quote, and those persons who violate treaties ought to be liable to prosecution in American courts. Despite the Constitution, the Senate and the House of Representatives have both rejected proposals by members that would require stricter practicing of principles. In September 1974, the House defeated a proposal to forbid the CIA from financing operations, quote, "for the purpose of undermining or destabilizing the government of any foreign country," end quote. A month later, the Senate defeated a motion that, quote, "would have forbidden any agency of the United States government to carry out any activity within any foreign country which violates or tends to encourage the violation of the laws of the United States or of such countries, except for activities necessary to the security of the United States and intended solely to gather intelligence," end quote. Nevertheless, the various investigating committees were established because of gross violations by the CIA and other agencies of certain American laws. Each committee adopted the same frame of reference, which, with a few exceptions, conveniently and effectively sets aside the ethical and moral considerations. They limited their concerns to compliance with American laws, not those of other countries, and to what security services should be allowed to do to American citizens, not to foreigners. Particularly in the report of the Senate committee, the ethical and moral issue tends to blend into the discussion of whether U.S. laws have been violated, not whether the U.S. government should or should not violate its treaty obligations or other countries' laws. The contradiction is, of course, insoluble so long as liberal and free institutions need direction, control, and funding by government, i.e., by the CIA. Most of the CIA's covert action operations imply corruption of non-government institutions which cannot seem to prosper by themselves. Thus, the real principle in operation is that free institutions, such as foreign electoral processes, must be made to work in favor of American interests. As increasingly they do not, they must be made unfree by control and direction in favor of the interests represented by the U.S. government. By concentrating on rights of Americans and compliance with American laws, the various reports interpose nationalism and the liberal concept of the state in order to obscure and conceal the national and international class interests that are the raison d'etre for the security services and for what they do. Even so, the revelations of domestic abuses are valuable as indicators of what should be anticipated when the next round of protest and pressures for change develops. Both the Senate Committee and the Rockefeller Commission reports show clearly the collection of information against dissenters, peaceful as well as violence-prone, and the use of the information to disrupt, harass, and weaken the organizations and individuals who were targeted. The picture emerges of an enormous covert action program within the United States against those who would correspond to the targets of the CIA's destructive covert action programs abroad, with the addition of certain liberal and right-wing groups. The principal agencies involved in the domestic security programs were the FBI, CIA, National Security Agency, U.S. Army Intelligence, and Internal Revenue Service. Among their targets were, quote, persons with anarchist or revolutionary beliefs or who were espousing the line of revolutionary movements, hate organizations, rabble-rousers, key activists, black nationalists, white supremacists, agitators, key black extremists, end quote. The sheer mass of files and investigations gives some idea of the scope of these programs. The FBI, for example, has an index of 58 million cards of names and organizations through which it retrieves information contained in over 6.5 million files. It has compiled 480,000 files from investigations of, quote, subversives, end quote, and 33,000 files from investigations of, quote, extremists, end quote. Through the Shamrock program of the NSA, which lasted from 1947 to 1973, millions of telegrams were intercepted and read. Between 1940 and 1973, 12 different letter opening operations were conducted by the FBI and the CIA, resulting in the illegal opening of hundreds of thousands of letters. From 1953 to 1973, the CIA screened more than 28 million letters, photographed the exteriors of 2.7 million, and opened about 215,000. The Internal Revenue Service targeted over 10,000 persons for special tax examinations for political reasons. The Army, for its part, amassed files on 100,000 Americans, quote, encompassing virtually every group seeking peaceful change in the United States, end quote. The CIA, in its Chaos program of disruption from 1967 to 1974, created 10,000 files on Americans with the names of 300,000 Americans indexed. The agency's main index file in the Directorate of Operations contains about 7.5 million names, down from 15 million a few years ago. It also has some 750,000 individual personality files. For collection of intelligence from American domestic sources, the CIA has another index, containing about 150,000 names and approximately 50,000 files on active sources. The CIA's Office of Security has some 900,000 files, almost all of which relate to individuals, including 75 sitting members of Congress. It also has records on about 500,000 people who have visited CIA installations, and until 1973, it maintained, quote, extensive computer lists of approximately 300,000 persons who had been arrested for offenses related to homosexuality, end quote. Although the FBI had been engaged in what amounted to covert action operations against left-wing groups in the United States since the 1930s, the main buildup came as a result of the civil rights and anti-war movements of the 1960s. Pressures from Presidents Johnson and Nixon to discover the, quote, foreign hand, end quote, behind these movements were partly the reason. but the information was also used in ways designed to weaken them. The FBI's programs to infiltrate organizations continue, with over twice as much spent in 1976 on informants against, quote, subversive, end quote, organizations than against organized crime. Besides asking what the different intelligence and security services have been doing, the House and the Senate committees also asked the question, how well have the services been performing? Success or failure, in this respect, depends on one's point of view. The Senate committee report cites the CIA's interventions in Guatemala and Iran and in Western Europe after World War II as successful operations, yet laments the intervention in Chile as lacking popular support of the American public. The breaking of American laws by the FBI, CIA, and other services is seen as failure, whereas the CIA's advanced technical collection programs are considered successful. On the other hand, the CIA is seen to have failed in fulfilling its original task of centralizing the intelligence collection, analysis, and production processes of the government. The House of Representatives Committee reported a number of dramatic failures of the CIA. Among these were the failure to anticipate adequately the Tet Offensive of 1968, the Czechoslovakian invasion by the Warsaw Pact armies, the 1973 Yom Kippur offensive by the Egyptians and Syrians, the fall of the fascist regime in Portugal in April 1974, the Indian nuclear explosion, and the 1974 coup against the Makarios government in Cyprus. One searches the reports in vain for meaningful evaluations of the CIA's interventions to install or strengthen the current repressive regimes in countries such as Indonesia, South Korea, Iran, the Philippines, Brazil, Uruguay, Bolivia, and Chile. Almost nothing appears to suggest that the CIA works intimately with the security services of these and other right-wing governments to support the torture, assassination, and other forms of political repression prevalent in those countries. Such support often has the effect of covert action operations because of its impact on local political stability. In a somewhat peripheral manner, the Senate committee recognizes this when it recommends that the CIA be forbidden by law from providing support, quote, for police or other internal security forces which engage in the systemic violation of human rights, end quote. Such a recommendation, if enacted, would be a positive development, but most probably the views of Senator Goldwater will prevail. In a statement of his individual views appended to the Senate committee report, Goldwater observed, quote, in some instances, it is necessary for U.S. intelligence services to cooperate with the internal security forces of nations where there is systemic violation of human rights. The purpose of such cooperation is to gain foreign intelligence on vital targets. In order to gain the cooperation of the internal security forces in these countries, support is sometimes a condition for cooperation. In a world where the number of authoritarian regimes far outnumbers the number of democratic governments, such a prohibition limits the flexibility of our intelligence services in defending America, end quote. Senator Goldwater might as well have been speaking for the CIA, but he too failed to acknowledge that the CIA supports political repression to weaken left-wing movements as a goal in itself, quite apart from the support given as an inducement to a local service to tap the Soviet embassy's telephones. Without adequately discussing the CIA's support and promotion of political repression, the Senate and House committees fail altogether to give the American people a better understanding of why a station chief was assassinated and why, indeed, the CIA is so despised and brings so much scorn on the United States in foreign countries. This omission should not surprise anyone, for, as with covert action operations, these activities are needed to prevent real change, or at least to delay change as much as possible. Many recommendations for reorganization and stricter control of the security services are contained in the reports. The Rockefeller Commission made 30 recommendations, the House Committee 32, the Senate Committee 87 on foreign intelligence and covert action, and 96 on domestic intelligence. The Murphy Commission made 14 recommendations directly relating to intelligence. practically all the recommendations are designed to strengthen the intelligence agencies of the government by making them more effective and keeping their operations secret. In all of the reports, more effective congressional oversight and control is recommended through the establishment of new intelligence oversight committees to replace the current weak supervision by Congress. Recommendations would also prevent future CIA lawbreaking within the United States and assassination of foreign leaders during peacetime. A number of bureaucratic changes within the intelligence community are also recommended, from changing the name of the CIA to FIA, Foreign Intelligence Agency, and giving the DFI, Director of Foreign Intelligence, an office near the White House, to abolishing the Defense Intelligence Agency. The recommendations also reflect wide agreement that the DCI's position should be strengthened so that he can effectively coordinate the whole national intelligence apparatus. The Senate Committee and the Rockefeller Commission recommended the enactment of legislation that would provide criminal penalties for unauthorized disclosure of secret government information, one of the measures designed to cloak the CIA in secrecy again. If enacted, such a law would make it a crime to leak to the press the kind of information that caused the investigations in the first place. Just how many of the various recommendations are finally adopted will depend in part on the Congress. President Ford, in February 1976, provided by executive order for a number of reforms and recommended others to the Congress for legislation, including the Secrets Act. The main feature of the Ford reforms is that they add and change names, but little else. Covert action, for example, now becomes special activities. A new committee of foreign intelligence chaired by the DCI is established in the National Security Council in order to improve management and budgeting of the intelligence activities. The 40 committee that previously was supposed to review and approve sensitive and expensive covert action projects is replaced by an operations advisory group and upgraded to include the secretaries of state and defense rather than their deputies. The DCI receives more power and, in effect, may become a strong director of the entire intelligence community with the assistance of a new deputy director for the intelligence community. A new intelligence oversight board, closely aligned with the inspectors general of the intelligence agencies, will presumably detect possible abuses before they get out of hand. Political assassination is declared prohibited, but other forms of covert action continue. The CIA's domestic activities are indeed curtailed, but exceptions to new rules governing the FBI would still allow for penetration and disruption of certain domestic organizations, those composed primarily of non-United States persons, by this agency. Nevertheless, President Ford asked the Congress for new legal authority to mail intercept operations and for repeal of the requirement that he advise the six congressional subcommittees of all covert action operations. Instead, only the new intelligence oversight committees would be kept informed, and to some extent, the doctrine of plausible denial might return. How, then, should we view these past few years? Does the continuation of the CIA's covert action operations abroad imply a defeat of those opposed to secret American intervention and support to political repression abroad? Does continuation of the FBI's collection of intelligence on left organizations inside the country also amount to defeat? I believe the revelations of the past few years constitute a great popular victory, even when weighed against the absence of effective reforms. In the first place, popular movements have gained a huge body of knowledge concerning the methods and specific operations of the institutions of counter-revolution. Obviously, one must know how these institutions operate in order to anticipate their moves and defeat them. Second, the revelations served to continue the alienation process, probably in fact to hasten the legitimacy crisis that every day is separating more and more people from the government and traditional institutions. What better subject could be found to demonstrate hypocrisy, corruption, and the ways in which the government in general tends to serve privileged minority interests? Third, the revelations, especially those relating to Chile, demonstrate more clearly than ever how the activities of the CIA are tailored to meet the security needs of American-based multinational companies. Much of the CIA's operational program in foreign countries, particularly in the Third World, can now be seen as designed to promote optimum operating conditions for these companies. Fourth, the revelations and investigations demonstrate once again what is best in the American system: separation of powers, free flow of information, checks and balances, need for protection of the individual from oppression by government bureaucracy. Fifth, the lack of meaningful reforms demonstrates the limits of the liberal reform process. Those who may have hoped for abolishment of the CIA or of covert action operations may well reconsider whether they may have been putting the cart before the horse. Only after power is taken away from the owners, managers, and their politicians can their instruments of repression be dismantled. After all, the law that established the CIA was based in large part on recommendations made by a New York investment broker. The revelations, scandals, investigations, recommendations, and reforms are also an integral part of developments in other countries. In Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, Mozambique, Angola, Guinea-Bissau, also in Chile, Argentina, Brazil, Indonesia, Iran, and Zaire, the investigations may have been a ruling class affair in the United States, but they are also a contribution to liberation movements everywhere because they are so instructive on the techniques and institutions of counter-revolution. Taken in the international context, these events constitute still one more important, yet partial, victory for ordinary people. There is no reason for paranoia on the part of those who reject and resist. The siege mentality is theirs as they try to hold on to each piece of territory for exploitation of resources and cheap labor. Yet no one can deny that socialism is advancing from region to region and from year to year. As for the CIA, those of us who are able should continue to make every effort to expose who they are and what they are doing in order to reduce their effectiveness and to hold them up to ridicule and scorn. In June 1976, I spoke at an alternative bicentennial celebration in Copenhagen. Also speaking was a representative of the Cherokee people of North Carolina. He described how fatuous the celebration of 200 years of conquest and exploitation was, since his people had been in America for some 25,000 years. He also described how Native Americans were marching across the country from the Pacific to the Atlantic coast. When on July 4, 1976, the candles were lit on the 200th birthday cake of the United States, the Native Americans, he said, would be there to blow them out. This attitude, the exposures of secret intervention and repression, and the continuing growth of popular movements in the United States are the real reasons for celebrating the bicentennial.